हरे रामा हरे कृष्णा, वेलकम बैक टू माय चैनल। सो हियर इज द 12th चैप्टर ऑफ भगवद गीता। इन द 11th चैप्टर यू मस्ट हैव लिसन दी दैट लॉर्ड कृष्णा हैज शोड हिज वेरी कॉस्मिक फॉर्म, ह्यूज फॉर्म टू अर्जुना एंड शोइंग हिम दैट ही इज अ सुप्रीम लॉर्ड। नाउ आफ्टर सीइंग ऑल सच थिंग ही वॉन्ट्स टू नो मोर अबाउट लॉर्ड कृष्णा एंड दोज हु एक्चुअली वर्शिप द सेजेस दी नॉर्मल पीपल, वट आर द एट्रीब्यूट्स ऑफ सच पीपल हु वर्शिप लॉर्ड सुप्रीम लॉर्ड। ओके सो हेयर आई वॉन्ट टू मैंशन दैट फ्रॉम द 7th चैप्टर टू 11th चैप्टर लॉर्ड कृष्णा स्पेशली लेड एम्फेसिस ऑन द इम्पॉर्टेंस ऑफ वर्शिप ऑफ गॉड हु इज एंडोर्ड विद एट्रीब्यूट्स एंड फॉर्म एंड इज ऑल्सो एंडोर्ड विद एट्रीब्यूट्स बट इज फॉर्मलेस। एट लास्ट he glorified exclusive devotion and its fruit. So in this chapter of 12th chapter, having heard the above description, Arjuna had a curiosity. He was so curious with the devotees of those who worship God with attributes or those who worship the unmanifested attributeless Brahma is better. So he puts the question in front of Lord Krishna that those devotees who ever steadfast thus worship three Sagun, and those again who worship only the imperishable and the unmanifest Nirguna, which of them are better versed in yoga? So Lord Krishna said, those who worship fixing their mind on me, worship me ever steadfast and are endowed with supreme faith are the most perfect yogis in my opinion. A striver whose only aim instead of hankering, you know, after worldly pleasure and prosperity is God realization, who is just thinking of Lord everywhere, it means that he has started realizing his real affinity for God. When he fully realizes this real affinity, he has not the least desire to hanker after worldly pleasure and prosperity through his mind, intellect, senses and body. He further says, now here is a distinction. Lord Krishna has said to Arjuna that, but those who worship the imperishable, the undefinable and the unmanifest, the omnipresent, who is omnipresent? The God, the Lord Krishna, Supreme Lord is omnipresent, the incomprehensible, the unchanging and the immobile, the constant by restraining all the senses, being even-minded everywhere, engrossed in the welfare of all beings also come to me. The senses of devotees who worship the Lord with attributes are fixed on him and so there is not much need controlling the senses as far as devotees who worship attributeless Brahma. In the Gita, control over senses has been considered very, very essential in the discipline of knowledge and action, and there is no stress in the discipline of devotion. Means devotion is controlless. When you have devotion to someone God, you cannot control that person. You just let the flow that you are the devotion of that God. The Lord wants to explain here that devotees following the path of knowledge, besides thinking of God in solitariness, should also be even-minded and in remaining established in Him and having renounced egoism, attachment for the body, senses and mind and intellect, totally satisfied but is really even-minded. He further says that difficulty in following the discipline of those whose minds are attached to the unmanifest is greater, for the unmanifest is hard to reach by the body conscious beings. So here the Lord Krishna is trying to say to Arjuna that the striver's thoughts are set on the unmanifest, are those who regard the worship of attributeless absolute as superior, but those minds have not entered the attributeless. In order to enter the absolute, a striver should possess three qualities: interest, faith and qualification. Such strivers, having heard the glory of the absolute, develop a bit of inclination and having faith, start the spiritual discipline. But because of identification of the self with the body and because of lack of respection, their mind do not comprehend with the absolute. But he further says and add that who worship me, surrendering all actions to me, regarding me as the supreme goal, meditating on me with single-minded devotion. Here he talks about in Gita, actions which are surrendered to God have been called Mother Parakarma, Madartha Karma and Mat Karma. Mother Parakarma are those actions which were started with any other aim but are surrendered to God either during their performance or after. Madartha Karma, actions which are performed only for God from the very beginning. They are performed by obeying Him in order to please and utilize Him. and matkarma are all mundane actions such as like business, service and spiritual actions, adoration, meditation, which are performed for the sake of God by regarding them as God. In fact, all actions should be performed with only the aim of God realization. He further says that to those whose mind is fixed on me, I straightaway deliver them from the ocean of the death-bound world, O Parth Arjun. He says that as an ocean consisting of nothing but water, there is nothing but death in the world. Nothing in the world is immune from the buffets of death. The Lord rewards men in whatever way they approach Him. So He declares that He is same to all beings. But those who love Him only, who perform all actions only for Him, and who, looking upon Him as the supreme goal, ever remain absorbed in chanting His name, thinking of Him and meditating on Him, He straightaway delivers them from the ocean of death, bounds and existence. He further says, fix thy mind on me alone and fix thy intellect on me alone. Thereupon thou shalt live in me entirely. There is no doubt about it. According to the Lord, only those persons are most perfect in yoga who have realized their eternal union with God. In order to make striver perfect in yoga, the Lord orders them through Arjuna to fix their minds and intellects on Him by regarding Him as the most loving and supreme goal. This is a very interesting thing that has been spoken about in this chapter by Lord Krishna to Arjuna. And he further says that if thou art unable to fix thy mind, if one cannot fix her mind, you know, mind steadily on me, then repeatedly try to reach me by the constant practice of yoga, divine name, etc., having God at its aim, O winner of health, Arjuna. The Lord says to Arjuna, if he is unable to fix his mind on him, he should seek to reach him by constant practice of yoga. I have mentioned this particular yoga in my other chapters as well, like in Sankhya Yoga, Karma Yoga, that through this, and even in sixth chapter as well, such an important chapter, that through yoga you can attain God as well. So Abhyas Yoga is a compound word in which Abhyas means fixation of the mind on something repeatedly, while yoga stands for equanimity. Thus, repeated practice by having equanimity in Abhyas Yoga, adoration, chanting of the Lord's name performed with the aim of God is also called the Abhyas Yoga. He further says that if you are unable to practice, even if you are unable to practice, be thou intent on performing ordained actions for me and thus doing selfless actions for my sake, thou shalt achieve perfection. It means that if you are unable to abhyas, to do abhyas yoga, means if you are, due to your busy schedule, if today's people unable to do yoga, just help someone. It could be either a relative, friend, family member or poor with self-love desire. You don't want anything from return to them, from them, okay? That is also kind of a yoga that you are giving your duty towards God. Lord Krishna further says that reporting to yoga, if thou art unable to do even this discipline mentioned in the preceding words, then subduing your mind, sense and intellect and renounce the fruit of all actions. In the preceding words, the Lord declared, the former can be called the path of devotion, while the latter the path of action. Both these are independent means of God realization. Also in this verse, the Lord has used the expression, in which more than one important in the path of action, because without renouncement of the fruit of action is impossible. Just leave every desire that you have and just help people. It means, it solely means that. He who neither rejoices, he further says to Lord, to Arjuna, he who neither rejoices nor hates, neither grieves nor desires, and who has renounced attachment and aversion in good and evil deeds, he who is thus devoted is dear to me. It means that that man is enlightened, that human being is enlightened, who doesn't desire anything, who doesn't have an attachment with anyone, who is not even good and not evil, you know, who doesn't really, you know, unfocus his mind when he hate someone or like someone. He just shall remain in every situation that God puts in him. Means that is the true devotee of, that is the main attribute, means focused on the Supreme Lord, no matter what kind of a situation you are going through. He further says that he who is alike to foe and friend is in honor and dishonor, also who is like in cold and heat, favorable and unfavorable circumstances in pleasure and pain, who is from attachment, free from attachment, who holds blame and praise equally, who is thoughtful, contented with any means of subsistence, who has no attachment to his body and his board is firm in mind, that man full of devotion is dear to me. You know, this is a very, very important shloka, which is, you must read this shloka when you read the 12th chapter of Bhagavad Gita. Being free from attachment, aversion is perfect devotee, is even-minded towards foe and friend equally, not to common, you know, not to talk of common men, even strivers are swayed by feelings of enmity and friendship towards an enlightened and devotee, but he ever remains even-minded to foe and friend. So those who is free from all the attachment from his relative, who is from like, you know, he's, no matter you are with your enemy, no matter you are with your friends, you doesn't differentiate between people. You're good to your enemy and you're good to your friend as well. This is like a like person is very dear to Lord. And those who with faith hold me as their supreme goal. It means that whoever whose life goal is to attain Lord Krishna, never unfocus his mind on worldly pleasures and follow this nectar of wisdom, law or doctrine. Such devotees are exceedingly dear to me. Means, it does not mean that there is no importance of discrimination in the path of devotion and no importance of faith in the path of knowledge. In fact, faith and discrimination play an important role in all spiritual path. Discrimination enhances devotion. Similarly, faith in God and in scriptures induces a striver to follow the path of knowledge. Therefore, faith and discrimination are helpful in both the path of devotion and knowledge. So, this is going to be the end of 12th chapter. I hope you like my video. So, I'm gonna do the end with it. So, with the Om Tat Sat, the names of the Lord in the Upanishads of the Bhagavad Gita, the knowledge of Brahma, the Supreme, the scripture of Yoga, and the dialogue between Shri Krishna and Arjun, this was the 12th discourse, is designated the Yoga of Devotion. I hope you like this video. Please like, subscribe to my channel and share this video. I shall come in the next video by bringing the 13th, 14th, 15th chapters.